you tell me about your debut album, Gold Blooded?
Tell you about it in just broad.
You've been working on it for a long time.
About the audio? About the sound of it?
Yeah.
Well, or just in general? Yeah. Well, okay.
Any?
So, alright. Gold Blooded. Well, I came out here to make the record about a year and a half ago.
And we spent 3 months in the studio. It was songs that I'd written mostly over the last few years, when it's like songs that weren't necessarily right for Killiana or for other things that I was doing. Songs that all, you know, that I thought were pretty personal and quirky and a little left to center. And I had like a body of these songs, and then I came out here, and the day I got here, I wrote this song called Gold Blooded, which became kind of like the crown jewel of those songs. And I just committed 100% to making the record, and then now assembling the band and playing out, and I'm really proud of it.
And this is all self-released with the Pledge Music?
Yeah, it's super, super DIY. So this is my bike gang. I'll be there in a minute. Hey Nick. Oh, hey Snake, I'll be there in 5 minutes. Just doing an interview. But well, it was DIY, like the whole thing was super indie. And I like that, you know. We just got a little bit of funding from an investor, and you know, enough to make the record, and then we just kind of assemble our team, like in the industry, kind of like the people that I know that actually love music still, like the few people out there that I'm really proud to say, like my friends and that do good work. And so we created this little dream team, like this perfect little record label of like, you know, our favorite radio people and marketing people and promo people and, you know, shooting a bunch of videos and giving it a good push. Like, it feels to me like a super solid push. It feels at least as strong as any record I've ever worked on before.
What was your favorite song to work on?
To record?
Yeah, or write.
Oh man, Gold Blooded was my favorite because it was just like, you know, it's tough sometimes. I think you write, songwriting is kind of a numbers game, like a lot of things in this world, you know. You kind of, you put the time in and you filter yourself, and one out of every like 50 things you do is like you hope like something really special worth sharing with everyone. And that was just one of those cool kind of perfect storms where the theme of the song, right, like what it's about and the lyrics coalesced with the tone of the music and the vibe, and then as I said, it became like the centerpiece of the record. So that was the most fun, because it's one of those things. There's certain songs that I don't care like how many times you hear them, you don't get sick of them. And that's not egotistical to say, because I'm the first one to get sick of my own songs. But this just had a real, Jeffrey, our bass player, calls it the end of summer song. It's just got like that nighttime drive on the highway with the top down, sort of slightly celebratory and slightly dark and depressing all at the same time. Like an up-tempo crier.
You've played a few shows so far. What seems to be the fan favorite?
We kind of start strong, like, and peter off. Like, that's kind of our trajectory. We like to, like, give a nice little, give them something delicious up front, and then bland, disgusting, awful, and then have a great night. So people are happy when we play our last song, because they're like, this is awful. No, I don't know. I mean, when we nail Falling in Love Will Kill You, that seems to be a fan favorite. It's a kind of a challenging little harmony. When we get it right, it really kind of clicks.
And you released that song on a heart-shaped vinyl.
Yeah.
How did that idea come about? I've never seen...
Yeah, I didn't even know that that was possible. And then I saw one, well, when I was looking through, like, the catalog of The Plant, and I'm like, can I do this? They're like, yeah. I'm like, how come no one's done this? They're like, well, some people have done it. I'm like, this is so fucking cool. Like, I'd expect that it'd be like some psychotic custom thing. They're like, nope, we just started offering that. So I'd like to think that we're kind of early on it, that maybe you'll start seeing more of those, and but I hadn't seen them.
Yeah, I thought that was really cool.
It's really cool. It's a 7-inch embedded within a larger 12-inch heart, so it doesn't fuck up your needle or anything. It's just a clever little novelty. And I'm a vinyl collector, so it was cool for me.
And you worked with Gerard Way and Morgan Kibbe and Sierra Kesterbeck. How did that come about, to collaborate with
buds,
them?
They're like, I'm lucky, like, in the case of Gerard, like, I was swept up in the record. Like, I was, I had a real, you know, kind of things can snowball for good or bad. Like, if you're having a really fucked up time in your life, you tend to attract other fucked up people, and then the more of you, then you just start to attract, and then bad things start happening, and then it just becomes this kind of momentum. So I witnessed, you know, a few times in my life where I witnessed that happening for good. And in the process of making the record, that was one of those vibes where I was really swept away by the positive sort of vibe of making the record. And so partially there's that, in the sense, like, I didn't hesitate before asking any favors. I was so, you know, again, like, kind of swept up in it, that I was like, oh my god, like, it would be so cool to have Gerard come by. Let me ask him. And just, you know, I was very lucky. He was off tour at the time. He was in North Hollywood. He has a studio down the street. And just lucked out that he came over and liked it and then suggested singing on it. And, yeah, that was just a really incredible thing, because he just crushes vocals. And I didn't think of him that way, because I mean, I guess I kind of take for granted, you hear people on albums, or even sometimes you hear them live, and you're like, ah, you know. And in the studio, under super controlled environment, you're like, fuck, you know, he's a, like, world-class vocalist. So that was a really special moment. And then, yeah, same thing with Morgan, speaking of world-class vocalists, and Sierra. And I didn't really spray and pray. It's not like I put out, like, dozens of requests. The few people that I just thought of happened to be available, and it felt right. Legally, it became kind of an issue, but I don't think that far ahead. It was later when they all did that, and I was like, well, this is rad. And then I'm like, I can't wait for this record to come out. And then the lawyers, like, do you have permission from their record companies? And I'm like, no. I'm just like, there's some things, as old as I am, I'm just like, should have known a little bit better than that. But we ended up being really lucky, and everyone was super cool, and their managers were super cool, so it's cool.
Do you have plans for a full tour or anything coming up?
Nothing on the books. Whatever. Like, it seems like we're just signing with a booking agent right now. And I just told them, like, yeah, get us solid tours. I don't want to waste anyone's time. I don't want to, like, go out to the middle of nowhere for no reason, but I would love a couple of solid support slots. Who should we tour with?
Can't think of anyone off the top of my head right now. There's probably a lot of bands that I could think of.
Yeah, I don't even know what my dream tour would be. This band, I feel like, belongs with, I don't know, maybe like English kind of like Rough Trade bands, maybe like 4AD bands. Like, yeah, like maybe, I think this band could tour with like a Grimes or something like that. Like a War Paint or something like that. Like a, this would be great. I don't know, it's fun to kind of kind of even just think about it. You just want to play ideally in front of people who get you. There's no fucking point otherwise. Like, you can open for, you know, it doesn't make any sense for us to open for some massive rock band if 1% of the people in the arena give a fuck about you. I'd rather go play a cafe, you know, get a free muffin.
You've been playing or doing music since the mid-90s.
Yeah.
How do you feel the music scene has changed?
Music scene?
Like, the industry and everything.
I mean, it's very, very different. When I started, things were probably, there's just still kind of like a cousin of the way it was in the 70s and 80s. So the kind of paradigm was still, you had a handful of huge labels with a shit ton of money. The guys running those labels were eating lobsters and didn't really listen to music at all. And people were overpaid and didn't really know, weren't really in touch with the fans. I've seen it, I've watched it all. I've watched it all change to the point where now there's music is 100% accessible. And at the same time, there's just so much garbage that it still almost comes down to, it still comes down to how does the fan learn about new bands. It's either from like a cool tour, a reference to another band that they already like, maybe a cool, I'd say like even like a cool radio station, a cool podcast, but again, like radio stations are virtually obsolete and there's a million podcasts to sift through. When I was young, I found out about bands from basically like one or two places. Like I got one magazine that I really liked, or one TV show. It was called 120 Minutes back in the day. That just, it was like, love 90% of these bands. So whatever they're gonna introduce me to, I'm gonna become a fan of. I don't know what it is these days. I don't know. I mean, we've all seen the industry change. I don't know where it's going. I do know that when places like media outlets suggested streaming this record for free, I was like, go, who cares, take it. Like, I'm definitely not precious with, you know, piracy and shit like that. I just want people to hear it. I just want fans.
Do you have anything you want to say to your fans?
I have fans?
Yeah.
To any of my fans that are watching, where the fuck are you? Just kidding. No, I don't know. I just say thanks for supporting this project. I think there's a ton of crossover. I think if for any fans of the early Kellyanna stuff, I think you really dig this record. And spread the word, you know? This is 100% DIY, so that means that we created a little record label called Sad Bat, we're putting this out on. So that means is one fan can make a difference. It means that one fan in your town, no matter where you are, if you shine a spotlight on this record, you turn your friends, your cousins, your pizza delivery dude onto this band, like, I notice that stuff, like, we'll see, like, oh wow, you know, something's happening in Montgomery, Alabama, or whatever. So I need some champions out there, and, you know, we're all super accessible, we're all super transparent, so they can find us, and we'll find you guys, and, yeah, spread the good word. Thanks for believing me.
Thank you.
Yeah.